It's your girl Bengali Black coming at you live from Code Switch Productions. Today we're diving deep into the past to explore the history of American cuisine. It's no surprise that Black people have had a big hand in popularizing some of the first dishes introduced to this country, and on today's episode we're going to take a closer look so we can give credit where it's properly due. So let's get cooking right here on Nacho Typical News. Okay, let's jump into some history. In order to understand American cuisine, we have to start at the beginning. America as we know it today was very different pre-colonization. Native Americans were hunters and gatherers who didn't purposefully cultivate crops. Instead, they lived off of what they could find, which consisted of varieties of beans, corns, and squash, just to name a few of the indigenous crops. Although they didn't farm as we know it today, they were all very well versed in how to grow crops that they wanted to eat, something they shared with the colonizers upon arrival. As we all know, farming became a huge industry here in the United States, built on the backs of our ancestors. One of the most influential farmers in American history was the third president of the United States, Mr. Thomas Jefferson. Although most of us are more familiar with the cringier part of his legacy, i.e. his inappropriate relationship with his young slave, Sally Hemings, he was actually America's very first documented foodie. Jefferson, a Virginia native, learned how to mine and manage a plantation from a young age. As Jefferson got older, he spent a lot of time in France during what we would know now as the Culinary Revolution. At this time, French chefs were really pushing the boundaries of food, and it really created a culture of people who enjoyed eating as entertainment. Jefferson became entranced with this lifestyle and set off to bring a piece of that French culture to America. When he returned to America, he began constructing his mansion, most notably his garden, which came to be known as Monticello. Monticello expanded a whopping 1,000 feet and had a sample of almost every Western food known at the time. For reference, that was over 330 varieties of vegetables and herbs and about 170 fruits known at the time. This garden was massive, and it definitely proved that Thomas Jefferson was a man before his time who thought outside the box. However, that's as much credit as I can muster to give a slave owner and a rapist. Besides, this isn't even his story. This is about the father of American cuisine, and his name was James Hemings. A little backstory on James is he was owned by Martha Wales's father, who was Thomas Jefferson's wife. When Martha's father passed away, it was Thomas Jefferson who inherited his entire estate, including 120 slaves, which included the Hemings siblings. The Hemings were actually Martha's half-siblings due to her father's rape of their mother, Elizabeth, which makes Jefferson's relationship with Sally that much more sick. His relationship to Martha allotted him and his siblings a better lifestyle than that of the other slaves. The Hemings were already accustomed to serving the Wales very closely, so it was no surprise that Jefferson entrusted brothers Robert and James with his most important tasks. James accompanied Thomas Jefferson to various meetings and out-of-town trips, and even allowed him to hire himself out to make more money. In 1784, Jefferson was appointed American minister to the French court and needed to take an extended stay in Paris. He sent for James to join him and his oldest daughter Martha in Paris, and for 2 years he studied under the best French chefs, learning all of the latest culinary techniques. At the time, slaves in Paris, even if they were foreign, were technically free and could earn a wage. Jefferson paid James, but only half the wage he used to pay his actual chef. Nevertheless, James worked his ass off and eventually became the manager of a famous French restaurant located in the American Embassy. He used his wages to hire a French tutor who taught him to read and write French, a skill that helped him maneuver the culinary scene much better. By year three of his stay in Paris, his little sister Sally arrived as the nanny of Jefferson's youngest daughter Polly. James was there to show her the ropes and even invested in an English and French tutor for his sister. They were said to be very close, something I think influenced their decision to return to Monticello together, even though in Paris they were technically free. At this time, 44-year-old Jefferson had forced himself on 14-year-old Sally, causing her to become pregnant. Jefferson, who became obsessed with Sally, begged her to come back to America, making her many offers before agreeing that her children would all become free if she returned. I think James was just trying to be a good big brother and watch out for his little sister, which is why he didn't take his chance at freedom. When they arrived back in the States, James was the top chef of his time. He organized the first American kitchen in New York City and was often called upon to cook for diplomats and other famous politicians. Thomas Jefferson's dinners became legendary, with many articles being published about his innovative cuisines. Dishes like French fries, ice cream, and champagne made their way to local households, all trying to keep up with the trends, and James was the hand behind them all. Many other Black household cooks were taught to model their techniques after James, which is something that helped shape American cuisine as we know it today. In Philadelphia, James was hired out to cook at famous households, which afforded him the same wage that many free citizens were already earning. While in Philadelphia, he had another shot at freedom as emancipation was on the rise there. Pennsylvania law stated that if a slave resided there for 6 months or more, they could petition for freedom. Unfortunately, for reasons we will never know, he decided not to take the opportunity again. Thomas Jefferson decided to return to Monticello in 1793, but this time James wouldn't go so easily. His fame and success had given him the needed leverage and confidence to stand up to his oppressor and advocate for his freedom. Although Jefferson didn't want to lose him, he agreed with one stipulation. James would have to train another slave of Jefferson's choosing to become as masterful of a chef as he was. The caveat to this is that only Jefferson could approve when the apprentice had learned enough to earn James his freedom. When they returned to Monticello, Jefferson selected James's younger brother Peter to be his successor, and they spent 3 years training. In that 3 years, Peter rose to the level deemed acceptable by Jefferson, and at age 31, James Hemings was finally a free man. Unfortunately, his life of freedom would turn very dark. Not much is known about James's life as a free man because once he left the Jefferson's estate, his journey wasn't well documented. We know from old letters that he may have returned to France to live as a free man. However, the French Revolution had changed the country dramatically. Poverty and violence would have left many of his friends and acquaintances dead, which is probably what made him return to America. As Jefferson's career took off, we know he sent for James many times to come back and work for him, but James always refused. He didn't want to return to a home where he had once lived as a slave, and moreover, he didn't want to work as a free man alongside people he knew and cared about who were still enslaved. Unfortunately, his life would be filled with strife and poverty. Being free in America was very different than being free in Paris. In Paris, he was seen as a chef, but in America, he was just another Black cook. He wasn't even allowed to cook in the finest kitchens anymore, nor was he even viewed with the same respect and regard he once was. Without Jefferson's endorsement, he was just another Black man trying to survive a system of oppression. Still, he pressed on, finding work at the kitchen of a Baltimore tavern. Jefferson insisted once more and finally convinced James to come back for a couple of months to work for him again. We know James did go back to Monticello, but for whatever reason, he did not stay. 2 months after he left Monticello, he unfortunately committed suicide. Those who were close to him around the time of his death cited that he had become very depressed and had started to drink very heavily. He would have been around 36 years old at that time. It's so sad to hear about James Hemings and know that after all he's done and given to our culinary history, his story isn't often told. Black people in general don't get enough credit for all of our influences in American cuisine, as it was our people making and perfecting iconic recipes. Dishes like macaroni and cheese were a dish that James perfected at the wishes of Jefferson, and it was also so revered that it became a staple at every fancy dinner in America. The impact of the Black chef reaches so deep that brands like Aunt Jemima and Uncle Ben stole the likeness of the comforting Black cook and marketed their products so people would affiliate them with good down-home cooking. But eventually, the culinary industry started excluding our people. Although Black cooks dominated the food industry for some time, it wasn't long before the government started requiring certificates to cook commercially. While that makes sense for safety, it was actually a tactic meant to exclude our people and replace them with trained white chefs. Slowly but surely, we were pushed out of the industry that was built on our backs. Those of our ancestors that remained in the food industry slowly succumbed to the stereotypes that being a cook was a demeaning position and that of a servant. It caused us to further distance ourselves from an industry we helped create, and yet our white counterparts capitalized and profited from it. Today, many Black chefs are shedding those stereotypes and reclaiming their rightful place in the food industry. In the last 10 years, we have seen an increase in Black chefs, and honestly, it's about damn time. If you know a Black chef that you want to big up, tag them below in the comments so we can check them out. We need to honor the legacy of our ancestors and be proud of all that lived within them and that now lives inside of us. After all, reclaiming power is learning to love what you were once taught to hate.
So guys, I hope you enjoyed today's Chef-tastic episode of Nacho Typical News. Unfortunately, James Hemings never left behind any memoirs, so we'll never know much about his personal life. He did, however, leave behind his recipes, which I'm happy to provide along with links to additional information in the description below. Also, guys, I want to give a huge shout out to Code Switch Productions. For more information on Code Switch, you can visit the links below as well. So, guys, that's all I have time for today. So I'll catch you next time for some great fun, some great food, and some what? some even greater history, guys. See you next time.